Stephanie Izard. I'm coming to you live from the Food Network Kitchens. I guess I can call myself now Iron Chef Izard. It has a nice ring to it, but I'm still just kind of getting used to that. Had to keep a secret for a little while. So a couple nights ago, being able to share with family and all of my staff that I am the newest Iron Chef, the newest one to the club, to the family, was really exciting. So I wanted to make for you today one of my favorite dishes that I made on this season of Iron Chef Gauntlet. I was kind of just waiting for the perfect opportunity to bust this one out. So when the egg challenge came up, I was like, yes, I have to do this. And Alex Granicelli was a huge fan of this dish, and she is the toughest critic of everyone, I think, the scariest judge. So the fact that she loved it means it's something that I really wanted to share with you guys. Something that's a little cool, it's from Japan. So one of my favorite things to do is to find street foods from around the world and bring them to our menus in Chicago. This is something that we actually have on our menu at Little Goat Diner. So people have it for breakfast, but of course our menu, it's a diner, so you can have food all day long. You can come in and have fried chicken for breakfast, or you can have this okonomiyaki for dinner. And on the menu we say okonomiyaki, and we say pronounced yum. That way you're not nervous to mispronounce it when you come in and just want to eat it. So people come in and say, I would like to get the yum. Can you explain that to me? And we have our servers just kind of go through all the textures and exciting flavors that happen in this instead of just putting all the ingredients on there, because it's basically a cabbage pancake and nobody's going to order it if we don't go into more detail. So I'm going to start making it. Starts off with just some high gluten flour. You want to make sure you use something that's nicely processed, really nice and fine, a 00 flour, or if you have an Asian market near you, a nice like white flour from your Asian market. Then I'm going to put some sweet potato starch into the blender. And I'll show you why I'm putting that into the blender. But it's interesting, when we started working on Duck Duck Goat, my Chinese restaurant, I learned that there's starches of all kinds, whether it's green bean starch or sweet potato starch, or there's just more than cornstarch out there. So this one works great with sweet potato starch. You could also put a tapioca starch in there if you had that, if you just happen to have that laying around. We're going to use the blender so that I can mix up this nori inside of there. So umami, I would say, is one of those words that gets floated around a lot, just talking about flavor profiles, and something that sometimes there's just not a better word to describe, something to really talk about that savory note that it has. And seaweed or nori is definitely the best way to really bring that into this dish. So we're going to put the seaweed, the nori, something that you would just have wrapped around your sushi if you're not familiar, but I just had a whole bunch of sushi last night here in New York, so I've been eating lots of nori. We're just going to grind that up. If you don't have a supersized blender like this, it works really well in any blender, and also you can just kind of break it up with your hands, so no worries if you don't have that. But I just want to show you guys how it's cool to think that your blender is not just for, we always use it for blending soups and making vinaigrettes and stuff, but it works great for dry ingredients too. We actually sometimes, if we don't have our spice grinder handy, we'll use our blender to grind spices too. So we're just going to put that right in there. Then I'm going to add in some baking powder, and this does use quite a bit of baking powder. This flour mixture that I'm making, you can actually buy it already made in a bag if you have an Asian market near you. Okonomiyaki flour, basically. And we put it on the menu at Little Goat, and we were going through like 50 pounds at a time of this okonomiyaki flour. And of course, you know, the prices start to add up, and that's always a concern in restaurants, is making sure that your price point isn't too high. And something this simple, we thought, all right, let's just figure out how to make it ourselves. So we looked at the packaging, saw all the ingredients, and we just played around for a little while. And I would say, first couple pancakes did not work so well. It happens to everyone, even to Iron Chefs, I'll say. But after a little while, we figured it out and got it to come together. The last ingredient that I put in was guar gum, which is definitely something you can skip. I know that's one of those ingredients that might be like, for me, it was a little scary. This is the one thing that we actually use it in at the restaurants. So it just brings a cool texture to the pancake. But if you don't have it, don't worry about it. You can definitely skip it. The pancake will still work. It just kind of makes the pancake a little bit stiffer and a little bit sturdier, but still great without it. So I'm mixing this flour mixture together, and I grab another bowl and just continue making our batter. Here we go. So I'm going to take a couple cups of this cool flour, 2 cups to be exact, and then add in a little bit of eggs. Here we go. And these look like some beautiful farm fresh eggs. Actually, in Chicago, we use a farm called Little Farm on the Prairie, is where we get our eggs from. I was a big fan of Little House on the Prairie growing up, so I got really excited. But we like to go to a bunch of our farms and kind of see where the food comes from. And I think even when it comes to such a simple ingredient as eggs, it was really cool to see how different farms sort of do it differently. The farm that we get them from is, you could be standing in the middle of the area where the eggs come from, and it's like you're in a living room. It's that clean. And each of the hens sort of has its little room that they lay the eggs in. Really cool thing to see. But it's always important, you know, you want to use like the best ingredients that you can find. So we're going to put in 4 eggs. There we go. A cup and a half of water is going to go in there. And just a little bit of salt. So really simple so far. It's basically a cabbage pancake. So this is what I was saying, on our menu we call it yum, because if we were to write cabbage pancake with pork belly and some bonito flakes, which we're going to add in a little bit, it probably wouldn't have it, the selling power that it does when we just call it yum. Just going to mix this up, and then we're going to add in our cabbage. If you don't have cabbage around, you could use some other vegetables. I've actually not tried it. I think it'd be really fun to try throwing in some different vegetables and see how it sort of comes together. I think some carrots would work really well. It could be really cool. Definitely interesting to sort of play around with things in the kitchen. I think for me, when I think of recipes, it's sort of understanding what each ingredient brings to the recipe. So in this, the cabbage is just adding this like nice sort of light crunch. It's adding a little bit of freshness. So if you don't have cabbage around, it's like, all right, let me think to myself, what else could I put in there that would do the same thing in that recipe? So I think some carrots would actually be really great and probably add some great color as well. Let's see if I can do this by myself. No? Sometimes when you're in another kitchen for the first time, it takes you just a second. There we go. I got it. All right, so I'm gonna put this on. It's a small burner, so I'm gonna go a little bit higher. I'm gonna put some oil in there. This is something that you wanna do kind of low and slow. You don't want it to be super hot, because it's just going to, instead of kind of puffing up and letting that baking powder do its thing, it might just burn on the bottom and the texture won't be quite as nice. So we wanna make sure that we do it kind of on the lower and slower side. Put our cabbage, let me get this out of the way. Start to let this get a little bit hotter. So this is something you would find like on the streets of Osaka, basically. And for me, I've not been there before. I love to, just as you know, you guys maybe are learning watching this video about something from another country, I love to watch videos from other countries and learn about the street foods and, you know, put it on my list of places that I would love to visit sometime. And Osaka is definitely one of those. But you can just look up, you know, pick a country, look up street foods from that country and find all these cool new things that you can try in your kitchen at home. Which, that's pretty much what I do. Right. See how our heat is doing. We'll just go ahead and put some of our batter in. So you can see it's not too thick, not too thin. I mean, it's definitely reminiscent of a, you know, pancake batter. When I was growing up, my dad would make either pancakes or waffles every Sunday, and we would take turns. Waffles were my favorite. My sister was a pancake person. And we would fight every Sunday of what we had the week before. But he definitely never put cabbage and nori in the pancakes. It was more of a vanilla, cinnamon, and nutmeg type of thing happening. There, you can hear a little bit of a sizzle. We're going into sort of a, I would say, a medium-high pan. Not too hot, not too cold. And we'll let that start to do its thing. Hopefully. You never know. When you're in a new kitchen for the first time, you always wonder what's going to happen. I think that's the scary part about going on Iron Chef Gauntlet or, you know, any cooking competitions, is you never know how things are going to work when you're, you know, doing in a certain kitchen for the first time. So we'll see how this goes. So it's going to work out and show you guys. I'm going to move it over to a burner with just a little bit more firepower, just so I can get a little more even cooking. There we go. See what happens. Meanwhile, I'm just going to get an egg started. And this is a great dish. You could do it with a fried egg, which I'm going to do. Or you could do it with a poached egg, sort of whatever you're in the mood for. You could also skip the eggs altogether if you're just not in the mood for breakfast. I was just chatting with some friends about breakfast in general and how, like, here in America, I had an omelet for breakfast today. You know, it's just kind of a go-to. You're going to have omelets, you're going to have waffles, you're going to have pancakes. But in a lot of other cultures, they go a little bit more vegetable, go more savory, have things that we might think of for dinner, for breakfast. So it's really cool to just sort of see what's, you know, happening in other cultures for different times of the day. So I think this dish could be something I need to have for breakfast because of the eggs and such, or you could definitely just have it as like a fun little snack in the afternoon. Here we go. Sometimes if I have friends over, I'll make this and just cut it up into little pieces. It's a great sort of finger food. Without the egg on top, you just kind of cut it up. While that's going, I'm going to grab a little pork belly, which I have in the cooler. It's nice to work with pork belly when it's really cold. And pork belly, of course, is just, it's what we make bacon out of. I think everybody's so familiar with just bacon, and sometimes we don't think about just really even where that comes from. So it's just a nice big hunk of pork belly, which is basically just the part of the pig we make bacon from before it's gotten a chance to turn into bacon, before it's been cured and smoked. I'm going to cut a little piece off. And I'm just going to slice some thin slices of this. This actually is funny. It actually gave me the most trouble on the episode of Iron Chef Gauntlet when I made this, because I put it into the blast chiller that's in the kitchen stadium.
thinking that it would chill in like 30 seconds. And it was still just a little bit loose and hard to work with. So this one I just had in the fridge for a little while, making sure that it's just got a little firmness to it, which makes it a little easier to slice nice and thin. And if you don't have pork belly around and you're just a huge bacon fan, which I mean, I would guess that most people out there might be bacon fans, go ahead and just, you know, put some slices of bacon on there. The thinner cut, the better. One of the really thick slices of bacon, which I love for breakfast, but they probably won't cook quite as well on the bottom of the pancake. So you want it to be a little bit on the thinner side. You could also, you know, go crazy and put little bits of sausage, really whatever you're in the mood for. Of course, you could leave them off also if you want to leave it vegetarian. In my pancake, it looks a little smoky, so we'll see if I might be going a little fast on that side, but I'm gonna lay this pork belly right across. And it's not enough pork belly to, you know, really detect too much. It really just adds like another layer of flavor to the pancake. This is one of those moments where I'm gonna flip this and think, I hope the other side looks okay. It is not burnt. It is nice and golden brown. I'm going to add a tiny bit more oil into my pan. Yeah. So someone just asked, Deb just asked what it was like cooking against three other Iron Chefs. I'll say traumatic. traumatic, amazing, awesome. I think when this last episode was getting ready to air, I was excited to see all the episodes, and I think they came together so well, and I'm kind of like this sometimes watching myself on TV, because you're like, oh my goodness, what did I say? And I think they, throughout the season, caught me with some really funny faces and sort of funny things that we were all saying. But cooking against the three Iron Chefs, I think I kind of blocked it out of memory a little bit. You know, those things in your life that are slightly traumatic, then you kind of block out a little bit, even if it's like cause for celebration. I think that this was one of those. I was excited to have the episode air so I could remember everything that actually happened. But you know, Bobby Flay is one of the unbeatable ones, so I think that I definitely need to get back and give them another try at some point. And then when it came time cooking against Michael Simon, really awesome. I really just want to take him down because he beat me on Iron Chef America years ago. And then it comes to like Iron Chef Morimoto. Just one of the scariest competitors that exists. You know, he's just truly amazing, and watching him run around the kitchen was just, you know, inspiring. And as soon as I saw that giant fish and knew that I had kind of like dug a hole for myself of like putting myself against Iron Chef Morimoto with fish, it's like, was this a really bad idea or what? It all worked out. I had such a great time, but definitely one of those things that I think I won't put myself in that position again. Not to go against three in a row. I've got a little fried egg going. I'm gonna turn that down to low so that I can let the whites on the top set. I'm gonna leave it nice and sunny side. And of course, put on whatever eggs that you like. Even if like scrambled eggs are one of my favorites, go ahead and put scrambled eggs. Whatever you wanna do.
Hey, Stephanie.
Yeah.
Another viewer named Anthony wants to know, why are you not using butter to fry your egg?
Oh, Anthony wants to know, why am I not using butter to fry your egg? That's funny, because I was thinking that just before we started doing this. I use oil just because I had it, but definitely go for butter if you have butter around. Whatever you want to use, but butter is my favorite go-to. We go through more butter than I should probably tell you at the restaurant. When we have folks come and sit up at the counter at Girl and the Goat, and they look at our like giant, they're like, is that butter? Yes, yes, that's butter. Yes, that's a giant vat of butter. No worries, it's going to taste delicious. So yeah, go ahead and throw butter in there for sure, Anthony. All right, I'm going to turn up my fryer oil just a little bit. I'm going to show you guys a fun little crunchy topper to put on here. In our restaurants, my cooks kind of make fun of me. There's a lot of go-tos. Chefs always have things that they just love to use, and for me, it's all about texture. I mean, flavor, of course, and I think that just kind of it is a given with me. All of my food has a lot of different flavor, but something that we do that I think sometimes you're not expecting and is a little bit of a surprise is the textural element on everything. So I'm going to make a tempura crunch to put on top of this. It's basically just taking tempura batter, which is super simple. We're just going to do equal parts of flour and cornstarch and then add in a beer. And though I love to drink beers with hops, you want to avoid something with too much hops for this. Something nice and simple like a lager, just so that you don't get those bitter notes. So it's about a cup of each to a whole beer. Maybe you should grab two beers so you can also enjoy a beer while making this. Although I guess not if it's for breakfast, but totally up to you. So we're going to mix this up, and then I'm going to use this same whisk to just drop it into my fryer and make some little crunchy toppers for our okonomiyaki. Mixing that up, and this actually ends up to be a really nice sort of mixture. We just started at the restaurants. We use tempura batter at all three restaurants. My three restaurants all highlight different sort of flavor profiles from around the world. But even at our Chinese restaurant, we still use tempura flour as a great way to fry anything. So I'm going to take this and just kind of drizzle in some little bits. Super simple and fun. It's like making some crunchy funfetti or something. Just going to drizzle that in.
Stephanie, Deb wants to know, now that you're through the gauntlet, what ingredients stay on your nemesis list and wish list?
Now that I'm through the gauntlet, which ingredients stay on my nemesis list and which are on my wish list?
Mm-hmm.
That's a tricky one. You know, looking back at the gauntlet, I think I'm definitely going to go back and kind of try to master my peppers a little bit more. And then I'm going to call up Bobby Flay and be like, hey, Bobby, like, I'm ready to go. We use peppers at our restaurants all the time, but I think just sort of studying the flavor profiles even a little deeper. Shishitos that were built, those are one of my favorites. They're fun because, like, one out of every 10 of them is spicy, and so it's like a little game of roulette. We say one out of every 10. Some people say one out of every 7. Nobody really knows the true answer, but it's fun to say that anyways. And I think that something that, you know, my favorite go-tos, I mean, it'd be fun. Now that Anthony brought up butter, I think that there should just be a really cool butter challenge for some sort of Iron Chef challenge. The next time that they choose that as some sort of ingredient with any chefs cooking off, I would like to be there. Butter is fun to work with. Ooh, you can see the pancake is getting nice and fluffy. I'm going to check the side that had the pork belly and see how the pork belly is cooking up. Our egg is fried and ready to go. Looking nice and crispy. I'm going to flip that and just let it cook through a little bit more. So we've got nice crispiness on the pork belly. It's going to add that richness and the fattiness and the yumminess that we all love from pork belly. At least, like, pork belly. I don't know why I always put it in my stomach. But it's not going to add, you know, an overabundance of flavor. It's not going to take over sort of the nuances of flavor going on.
Sandy wants to know, was that Napa cabbage, and can she use another vegetable instead?
Sure. The question was that Napa cabbage, and can you use another vegetable instead? Definitely. This was actually just ahead of straight up green cabbage. You can use Napa cabbage. You could even, bok choy would work really well, which I think is a cabbage that has a little bit of spice to it. Some shaved Brussels sprouts would be awesome. I know that I think a lot of people are fans of Brussels sprouts. I myself, especially shaved really thin and used that way. So that would be a great thing to put in. And I really think that carrots or any sort of root vegetable, especially in the wintertime if you are making this, adding in some sweet potatoes or some sort of root vegetable, I think would be really great. I'm going to put together a really simple garnish for the top of this, just some scallions and cilantro, so we can start to get it plated up and really bring together all the different textures. So we've got some scallions, just cut nice and thin. They're just really fresh. I think with herbs, it's, what are your favorite herbs? Go ahead and put those on top. I think, you know, cilantro, some people have an aversion to cilantro. We have a lot of guests that come in and they say, it tastes like soap to me, which I think is just a natural thing for some folks. So skip the cilantro if you want. Go ahead and throw on some fresh mint, some fresh basil. I think one of my favorite herbs these days is sorrel, which adds a lot of really nice brightness. Today we're just going to use cilantro and scallions. So I've got my pancake, I've got my egg. I'm going to start plating and show you how this all comes together.
All right. Chef, Shauna wants to know if you have to use a cast iron skillet or if you recommend using a different type of skillet.
So Shauna was asking if a cast iron skillet is necessary, if you could use a different kind of skillet. I think something non-stick works the best, or a cast iron. That way your pancake, you don't have any issue with it sticking. But I would say when we make these at the restaurant, we just use a regular non-stick pan, and it works just great. All right, so we've got the egg, we've got the pancake ready to go. I'm going to take, this is a unagi, which is basically a soy glaze. If you go out for sushi and you get unagi, which is freshwater eel, this is the glaze that would go on top. We actually make this in-house and sell it in the bottle. You can look on our website, but it's something that's really simple to make, and you can also just find it at the store already made. It almost looks like I'm making a regular, like, American breakfast with maple syrup, but it has a lot different taste. And then we're going to put some Kewpie mayo on top. This kind of mayonnaise has just a lot of, has that tangy zip that we might have all grown up with, but just has a lot of great flavor, and you just want to go back and forth really fast so you don't end up with too many globs, but you get lots of sort of richness. Then we're gonna put our fun tempura flakes on top for crunch. So imagine just biting into that really soft pancake with a little bit of texture from the pork belly, but then you just get this sort of, this crunch that looking at the plate, you might not expect it. That's what makes it so fun. We'll put on some bonito flakes. Now this is that, you know, going back to that whole umami thing, this is gonna add a lot of that flavor. you definitely skip this if you're a little nervous, but I highly recommend just going and finding bonito flakes. It's just a dried tuna flake. And it's fun because when you put it on something hot, I don't know if you guys can see that, it's like moving just a little bit. They dance around on the plate. You can see the little bits kind of dancing. So when we send this out to tables, they're like, my food is moving, which is fun, of course. And then lastly, our herbs. We're just going to put those on top. And there we have it. This is Okonomiyaki. As I said, just call it yum. It's delicious. Lots of textures, lots of flavors. Lots of fun on a plate. Awesome. Well, thanks everybody for tuning in. It's great to be here in Food Network Kitchens in New York. And hopefully I'll be back soon cooking some more fun stuff. But until then, go out and experiment and try stuff from around the world. Okonomiyaki. Fun. Bye.